Hi, this is Steve.
This is Jay.
This is Bob.
This is Liv.
And we are Alpha Quadrant 6. We are a science fiction review show. And today we are reviewing Captain Marvel.
Or is it Captain Marvel?
Marvel, all right.
Not to be confused with Carvel, right. Which is delicious ice cream.
That's a very different movie, Captain Carvel, although I'd see that. So we are going to do a spoiler-free review for the first few minutes. We'll give a good overview of the movie, and then we're going to delve into some details, and we'll give you the warning before we get into the big-time spoilers. So who wants to start? Overview of the movie. What did you think? Captain Marvel.
It was awesome.
You liked it?
It was so much fun. Yeah, it was neat. It was a little bit different, you know, than your typical Marvel movie, different kind of structure of the origin story. And it was just fun. I liked it.
Jay, I know you had a different opinion.
I enjoyed watching the movie.
Yeah.
It was, you know me, I like the little details mean a lot to me.
Mm-hmm.
So there was detail problems with this movie. You know, without getting into too many specifics, you know, really it came down to some writing continuity problems. I thought that there was some, you know, some poor acting going on here and there. But there were some fantastic things about this movie. Sam Jackson was amazing.
Samuel Jackson was great.
Yeah, it was a pleasure to see him in a role that encompassed the whole film.
Yeah.
And
the de-aging CG, by the way, was seamless. It's like now it's not even, you don't even notice it.
It didn't even occur to me that he needed to be de-aged. That's how good it was.
When you're first looking at it, you're like, whoa, first off, Fury doesn't have an eye patch, and he's clearly much younger than we've ever seen him. And if you've been watching the Marvel and some superhero movies over the years, there clearly has been this de-aging push for a lot of the main actors. The first time I remember seeing it was in an X-Men movie, 2006, I think it was, with Patrick Stewart and Ian McKellen. And clearly, you look at them, you're like, whoa, it was shocking. And it was impressive at the time. I remember watching it, though, that it clearly, once you start talking and emoting, you get some weird effects, and it looked good, but not great, not like it does today.
Today it's great.
And then you could Kurt Russell, Iron Man. They did it in Ant-Man. So they're doing these really. This is one of the best that I've seen.
Tron 2 was probably the worst.
We're saying that was the first time I remember seeing de aging.
Which one?
Tron 2. They did like full CG. You know, de aged.
Right. It was horrible.
It was bad.
I think it was
on
a different company that did it.
Yeah.
Lola visual effects. They're pretty much at the forefront. Weta does a great job. ILM does a great job. Lola, I think, is doing an amazing job. And but it's really interesting, though, because they now have the digital beauty contracts on movies where you could specify that they're gonna whiten your teeth, they're gonna get rid of some of the fine wrinkles, you're gonna lose some weight. They actually have these contracts where you specify what they can do to you and what you can do to them digitally up to 70 years in the future. Really interesting, and it points to, I think, a period in time we might see entertainment as like post-human. Where there's not going to be too many humans in there because they're not going to need humans once they get rid of the Uncanny Valley and some of these other technical problems. It's fascinating to see where this is going to go.
I kept thinking how trippy it must be for Clark Gregg and Sam Jackson to be watching themselves
Coulson, baby.
On screen doing things that they just did, looking like they did, you know, 15, 20 years ago.
Yeah. But I mean, I think it's great, though, to be honest with you, because the movies, and I like when the movies are not so linear, right? And so as a franchise, the Marvel movies are jumping around in time. This movie took place in the 1990s.
Yeah.
I like the fact that it didn't like come right out and tell you what year it was. You kind of had to figure it out. Oh, there's a blockbuster. And look at those computers.
And the T-shirts.
Right. And then later on, they sort of confirmed the day. It was 1995.
The TLC song related.
Yeah.
Like, I know what year it was.
When I saw the blockbuster, though, I'm thinking, wait, I think I know for a fact that there's one blockbuster left on the planet.
It's in Alaska.
I was a decade off. When she first landed, I'm like, oh, it's got to be. I saw that one car. There was a K car. I think that the security guard was in a K car. I'm like, oh, that's the 80s.
No.
And then my wife was literally like getting it down to the year. Then they actually said what year it was.
Yeah, it was 1995.
6 years from,
It's good that you can have the same actor playing themselves younger. Because remember, a lot of older movies, they would have a younger actor play a younger version of an older actor.
Yeah.
And you had to just sort of suspend. It didn't look anything like them, you know.
Yeah.
This is great having Samuel Jackson play a younger Sam Jackson, and it's seamless. It's great. You can jump around in time and not be taken out of the movie.
Yeah, one of the drawbacks, though, and it's not a drawback because a lot of the actors that have had this technique done on them, they just happen to age incredibly well.
They're picking the low-hanging fruit, is that what you're saying?
Ant-Man guy. Rudd?
Paul Rudd.
Paul Rudd. He's awesome. The guy, you look at him from 20 years ago, he's got a contract with the devil, this guy.
But a lot of these actors, finally starting to age a little bit, and it's freaking me out.
But so a lot of them, Sam Jackson, I'm trying to find a recent picture of him. The guy is aging incredibly well, but still they did an amazing job. The real test is when they have somebody that's much older looking than him.
Well, Michael Douglas.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. I mean,
and Ant-Man, yes. That was a great job. Not seamless, though, but very good. Very good.
So I thought the movie was great as well. I really enjoyed it. I agree with the problems. This is a flawed movie, but that didn't take away from me the enjoyment of the movie. I enjoyed it despite the flaws, which I have to acknowledge. So I thought the writing was great. And we'll get into the plot when we get to the spoiler version of it, because we can't really tell you too much about it. But this was definitely Captain Marvel's origin story, mm-hmm. right? Yep. And this is teeing her up for the Avengers.
Yep. Which Infinity War 2.
Infinity War was coming out later this year. So that was great. But there was plot twists in there, and I really liked her character. I know there's different opinions about her acting, but I thought she did a great job, honestly. If you realize that she's playing a military officer, you know, she's an Air Force pilot, and she's playing that kind of character, it worked. I read some reviews before I saw the movie, and her acting was described as wooden.
Mm-hmm. I didn't get that.
Not at all. So it was totally different than what I was expecting based upon some of the reviews. Her emotional range was actually really good. She was funny at times, emotional times, but her baseline was serious. But I actually like that about that character. And this is, there are superheroes. One of the things that I like about superheroes is that they get shit done, right? They care. They care. And they're relentless, and they do what they have to do until the job is done. And that was her, and she played that character, and it was fine. It totally worked for me.
And I didn't feel bored by her. No. Like, it wasn't like, oh, well, she's wooden because she's in the military. Right. Like, I was entertained by her the whole way through.
You guys didn't feel like two-thirds into the movie, there was a good 20 minutes that were just like watching paint dry.
I didn't get that.
No, I didn't get that at all. Yeah. And she, if she is a little buttoned up, it's okay, because you got Samuel Jackson eating up the scenery like a champ. He was the foundation of that movie. I mean, the movie would have been
well. The character's
still enjoyable.
Great, and he's great.
Right.
So
it's a great pairing. It would have been a very different
movie.
They
had good chemistry, I thought.
Yeah.
Oh, they had great chemistry.
Well, their chemistry was probably the highlight of the movie.
It was. It was the core of that movie. Yeah. And she's the straight man in that dynamic duo, so that's fine.
Yeah, the only regret I have is not seeing more Coulson. Come on, you know what?
I know.
I love that guy. He's awesome.
Coulson. But maybe maybe in the next movie.
Maybe.
But he's always in the movies. He's always kind of a
he's
cameo kind of character, working behind the scenes.
He doesn't need to be.
Well, I don't know about that.
I saw Shield the series.
Well, yeah.
I was watching him all the time.
All right, let's move on to spoilers galore. Not watch past this point if you don't want to know everything that happens in this movie. So if you've already seen it, this is what we thought about some of the shit that went down in this movie. So let's talk about the problems.
Okay.
That's okay. Let's just start. Let's get this out of the way. There were lots of problems. A lot of them are the kind of things that we just sort of take for granted in superhero movies. Like, all right, the big thing is, how does she get her powers? I thought it was a very 1950s-esque way of getting her powers. The thing blows up, the energy core blows up, she gets overwhelmed with energy, and instead of melting, the energy gets absorbed into her. She can use the energy to do super powerful things.
But the guy, what's his face, Jude Law's character,
he was wearing armor.
He was a little further. No, but his head was exposed.
He was out of the superhero blast radius.
Yeah, I guess so. But
come on.
He didn't do anything other than knock him down.
I'm sorry, radiation kills you. Gamma rays kills you.
Yeah,
exploding
exactly.
energy cores kill you. None of these things make you superheroes.
But if you're a mutant, if you're a mutant, which I suspect she has to be in order for her body to absorb, we've seen other mutants absorb energy, mm-hmm. and it's the perfect thing. If they just gave us a little inclination, even like one person who knows, could have been Jude Law's character saying, I just still don't understand how that thing
I agree.
Went you out.
That was a moment that they could have had there, and I agree. I would like it better myself if she had nanites inside her, or she was a mutant, or there
nanites.
Was some reason why she could absorb that energy and use it rather than just melting her.
Yeah.
Right? That would be nice. But we have to kind of say, okay, fine, it's the Infinity Stone. And you can, I have a certain amount of tolerance for the hand-waving retconning in these movies. And so that's why that didn't take take me out of the movie. That's what I expect in superhero movies. But it was an opportunity lost.
I will remind you, though, overall, writing has dramatically improved in the last 10 years. And things that were okay in the 50s and 60s and 70s, whatever, even like...
I agree. That's what I'm saying. This was an opportunity to up it up a notch, and they didn't do
that. It is. But don't forget, though, we've never really been huge fans of Captain Marvel going back decades, right? I'm not sure how the purists would feel about messing with her origin. That, you know, that's a very touchy subject. You can't mess that up. You know,
I disagree. With Spider-Man, making it's not a radioactive spider, it's a genetic manipulation spider. That just makes it make more sense.
Yeah.
So
that's
adding a techno layer to make it make a little bit more sense, even though it's magic, you know,
fine. I agree with adding layers, but I'm trying to think of a reason why they were maybe treating that as a little sacrosanct.
Just
but
make
you're
it
right.
a little more plausible.
I agree.
That's all I ask
for. You don't need a wholesale change, but add that techno layer. I like that.
All right, so couple more big ones, like the glaring things were. There's no way that Skrull, is it Skrill or Skrull?
Skrull.
Right, just make sure. Because but you know why I don't know? One, I didn't read the comics about Captain Marvel. And two, the actors that had the prosthetic teeth in, everything was slurred to me when they were talking,
but
which is another complaint I have about the makeup. But the Skrull, scientists could not have made that jet. Regardless of the fact that it had a scramjet engine on it or whatever, it could not have handled outer space.
But again, that's so easy to just say, well, the guy had advanced technology. He did whatever he had to do to that ship. He nanited the thing to make it all seamless.
Again, Steve, it's those throwaway lines where they say, what if I came up with what they needed to do.
Yeah.
All he had to do was be like, yeah, I could just attach this field generator on there that'll give it shielding.
I know, and he probably did do something like that, but you're right. Throwing away a line just to take care of, you know, people like you who are like, how are they...
That was a jet. You understand the difference between a jet and an aircraft that can handle the vacuum of space?
But it was upgraded by alien super technology.
Yeah.
So
it's not like he pulled that thing into the alien garage to jack it up. And
you don't have to when you have alien super technology. You just attach the nano fabricator to it and it redoes it.
I hope so.
Remember, this is
the suit that can do that.
Yeah, this is the same universe where the raccoon was just spraying the ship with nanites and it was rebuilding it, right?
Even I thought that was a little whack.
Yeah,
this is that same universe.
Spray tech.
But look, I admit it. I'm an older man now, right? I'm older, and I have a lot of information in my head, so I can't sit there like a teenager and not 100% realizing.
I get you.
Like,
technically, that thing is canon, right?
Yeah, that's my point. It's canon. But speaking about
canon.
So the thing I had a problem with her throwing the missile back. So first of all, they're attacking the planet with a bombardment of missiles.
Now this is
and they're all clustered together, so if you blow up one of them, they all blow up.
Close.
That was silly. And then she's like totally Superman. It was just flies up to the cone and then just throws it. You know, I would have liked her to turn it around or something. I don't know.
It didn't feel like the missile itself could have handled what she did to it.
Yeah.
Because she didn't turn it around. She just stopped it and pushed it back.
Yeah.
Which means that, like, how fast did she deaccelerate that? I hate thinking of this stuff when I'm in the movie because I'm psycho. Yeah.
You don't want the physics to slap you in the face.
Right.
It's okay. We know it's not realistic. Of course, it's a superhero movie, but you don't want to be like, well, that wouldn't work.
Yeah, for me, one of the biggest superhero faux pas is deals with structural integrity. Like the Hulk picking up a tank by the fucking...
The muzzle.
By the nozzle, muzzle thing and swinging it around. It doesn't happen. Or the worst and most iconic, somebody's falling and Superman swoops down and just grabs her. It's not the fall that kills you.
Or
it's the deceleration.
They grab you out of the way of the oncoming train, but meanwhile, they just accelerated you at a 300G to do so.
Exactly.
You're still dead.
Those are in every superhero movie.
I know.
And it pisses me off every time.
And there was one of those in this movie. There was another one when Sam Jackson was holding the cat. That was a phenomenally wicked alien.
Yeah.
He's holding the cat, and these gigantic tentacles that go out about 10 feet come out of its mouth and are batting people around. But yet he's holding the cat. So if you think about how heavy that cat would have actually had to have been in order to hold all that matter.
Well, actually, I looked this up.
Yeah. No way.
Yeah.
Why, is it anti-grav cat?
Well, the cat contains a pocket dimension. a gateway to get a pocket out. Dimension.
That's
I'm
why.
Serious.
That's why I could eat the of Tesseract course. And yeah. not show it in its stomach.
I yes, assumed it was a exactly. pocket dimension. How else could you explain that?
So maybe he just keeps his tentacles folded yeah. up in there.
Of course he does.
Well, plus he could have been supporting his weight with one tentacle while he was squatting with another one.
You could come up with a lot of things.
You could kind of see that the tentacles were all over the place.
But the thing that Liz says is the answer. That's the yes. answer, and I can understand how that would have been hard to write into the
yeah.
Oh,
and
that's
how would they know that?
Yeah, he
would.
No, but it's not even. But the pocket dimension doesn't solve your problem, Jay, because
once they're out in our dimension,
the tentacles come out into that dimension, and the torque and the twisting and all.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah it still would.
He
would have been
be
impossible.
Going like this,
well, no, it would have just ripped itself right out
right,
of his hands.
Right.
Yeah.
So okay,
well,
fine.
Unless it knows what it's doing and it's supporting itself with some tentacles and balancing all the forces.
Some other abilities.
Yeah, right.
But
that's true.
It did. That pulled me out for a second. You know, and it, yeah. You know, the fewer times you pull someone out, especially geeks like us, the better.
Yeah. Bob, so, it's so hard to write movies that we're not going to get pulled out of because we're like,
that's
again,
why they need us for
exactly. And at the end of this show, we're going to give you our phone number. So I have a few more, and these are not in order of importance. What? This is all part of the review. Okay. I didn't like how blasé Nick Fury's eye, yeah. losing his eye, actually was.
I didn't like it, actually.
I didn't like it. Now, I'm going to talk first.
Go ahead.
Okay. I
didn't
like
preparing
it. I'm going to look to the camera.
I'm preparing
I didn't
that.
Like it. No, to me, Nick Fury, even though he is funny, there is aspects of this guy that are funny, and he showed his humor in this movie way yeah. more than in any other thing. And I get it, because he, you know, we're not just seeing him come in and sneak into somebody's house and hold a gun up to them. It's like, you know, we're seeing like long stretches of Nick Fury. To me, like, his eye was a testament to he's a badass. He's been through hell to get to where he is. He sacrificed himself to get to where he is. And I don't know, man, the cat scratching his eye, he didn't even go to the doctor. Like, I didn't realize that he lost his eye until they brought... No, I knew that he was going to lose his eye from it.
Yeah.
But to me, the cat scratch wasn't bad enough for him to lose
right.
his eye. They didn't explain it.
Alien infection.
So I just wanted that... See, do you understand that unconsciously I was building in all
yeah.
that gravitas yeah. into him losing his eye and to find out that he's lying to everyone. He's like,
that's why I liked it.
He's mystifying it in a totally cheesy way. I didn't like it.
First off, there have been periods in my life when I've gone to sleep wearing like an eye mask every night because I'm seriously convinced that my cat is going to claw my eye out in my sleep. So I felt very realistic to me.
Yeah. Especially a multidimensional alien
yeah.
cat. Yeah.
So in my mind, like, the cat scratch is actually way more epic than you would think that it would be because it makes me think of like Frodo getting stabbed by the Nazgul and he's going to live with that injury
yeah.
for the rest of his life. It'll never fully heal.
It's
and
not,
I think that's
it's
what
just
the cat
not cool enough. You know what they did?
But here's the thing.
Yeah.
I like it when movies break expectations like that. His iconic badass, you know, eye patch.
A kitty cat
scratched his eye out. Is like
stupid shit happens to really cool people.
Yes.
I know, but this is fantasy. You understand? This
right,
is
and that
up.
Was cool. I like
so,
that breaking expectations.
Another thing, though, there in the library. That it wasn't a library. When Nick Fury, they were turning on the lights in that dark room,
yes.
like that storage room.
Yeah, the storage
the
room.
Like,
yeah.
In the government facility. Which would be a great location for a zombie movie, by the way.
Yes.
Oh yeah.
And then the Skrull. Thank you.
The Skrull with an R.
The Skrull guy gets on top of him, and right then my wife leans over to me and goes, "Oh man, he is totally gonna rip Nick Fury's eye out." And I'm like, "Yeah, this is cool. Like he's." Because, you know, I had an expectation get set up that got ruined because I'm thinking, oh, Nick Fury becomes Nick Fury by him losing his eye. Like, this was his
yeah.
indoctrination into becoming, right? Like, the first time he meets aliens, the first time he's meeting superheroes, the first time, like, and then
right.
for it to be the cat, I'm like, oh, it defied
your expectations, right?
It was what?
It defied your expectations.
My expectations were delicious.
But the defying expectations was also a strength of this movie.
You think so?
I think the
yeah.
best part of this movie was the huge plot twist,
yeah.
right? You all agree
great.
With that?
It was
so
great.
Huge plot twist, going to ruin the whole movie for you.
They're
and
they're
the
called,
cat.
They're
the
called
cat.
The Skrull. You're talking about the Skrull?
Yes, the Skrull with the bad guys.
The Skrull with a U.
Yes.
Okay.
And they were plausible bad guys, and they behaved like bad guys,
yeah.
but...
And you wanted them dead.
And you wanted them dead.
You're
like, oh, man, and they infiltrated the Earth. Oh, my God, we got to make sure we eradicate it. You really built it up well in the audience that we wanted them dead.
Yep.
And then we learn, of course, that they're actually the good guys.
But wait, we didn't learn it like a switch.
No.
It took 40 minutes of movie time for me to slowly realize that there's not going to be a weird double cross. There wasn't a ha-ha. You know, it was just... They were the good guys, and everything was twisted. twisted because it reflected what was going on in her memory. So we slowly, as the audience, this was the best piece of writing in the whole movie.
Yeah, it was very good.
We slowly gained our trust in them exactly like Captain Marvel did.
Yes.
And it was I loved that writing. That was brilliant. Yeah,
and that main Skrull, I kind of love that guy. He was just so funny and interesting. And
he was the bad guy in Rogue One. An excellent actor. I really like him. And casting him as the bad guy in this movie was a masterstroke.
Was inspired. Because if you actually knew who he was, which I didn't, you'd say, oh, yeah, of course he's a bad guy. He was a bad guy in Rogue One.
If you think back to the way that he was talking to her when we first met him, when she was upside down, he was being charming even then. He was a good guy then, and you just didn't realize it.
He was the charming bad guy with personality, except that he wasn't.
But I love when movies, like, there's a reveal, and then you have to rethink about everything that happened up to that point. You realize, he was the good guy throughout the whole movie.
And the best example
we
of
didn't
that,
see it because we were looking at him through Jude Law's distorted misinformation.
And of course, the best example of that
is
I see dead
people. Sixth Sense.
That was the one where you're like, you literally go through every scene in the movie. This is another example of that.
If you haven't done it, have you watched the movie again after knowing that?
Of course.
You watch the movie again, you're like,
and
oh
then you're
my.
Just like, you're smacking yourself.
I know, oh my God. But it's brilliant. That was brilliant.
That was brilliant, and
And this movie was similar, not that at that level, but it was similar in that you like, they were not acting like really bad guys the whole time.
Another takeaway for me was it was so obvious that they were wearing makeup. Mm-hmm. You know, like I heard, I had this was a problem that I had with Star Trek Discovery.
I mean,
with
the teeth.
The actors are acting through fake teeth.
Yeah.
And, you know, I keep wondering, like, you know, they can do such brilliant things with special effects. Why don't they just special effects teeth onto them now? Mm-hmm.
You
know,
you probably should just CG the teeth now so the actors can talk without talking through teeth.
But they do like dubbing, what's it called, after the movie? They do
ADR.
Don't they do that? Lots of
apparently they didn't, Bob. Because
lots of the movies ADR.
They didn't do it because you could hear it, and that does bother me.
I
mean, you got to think. You know, there's so many things that are broken about it because you know every alien in almost every movie speaks English and blah blah blah. You know, we could get into all.
No, but they did point to a universal translator.
Yeah, that was nice.
That was a nice little throwaway.
Nice
talk. I like that.
Yep. If you kind of think about it, like obviously it's irritating that they're not speaking so clearly, but they're kind of in like the classic bad guy makeup.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
A little bit. Playing more into that.
Yeah.
So, a couple other nits. Jude Law's ship gets shot out of the sky, crash lands on Earth, then Captain Marvel comes down, and then, you know, I don't think that she should have sent. Steve's like, she's a good guy, she wouldn't have killed him.
She's a good guy.
You did change my mind about that, because she is basically like a Superman-level good guy here.
Yes.
But his ship crash landed and was broken. That's why it crashed.
Mm-hmm.
And she just like shoots his engine with her power beam, and it takes off again.
But you see, what you're missing is that it wasn't the power beam; it was the repair beam.
Exactly.
Right?
That just was bad writing. They needed to re-engineer the whole.
No, that was silly. Yeah, that was definitely silly.
They just needed to get Jude Law alone with her.
It's
somehow.
It's almost as if at that point, like, you know what? Maybe we shouldn't kill off Jude Law because we might want him in the sequel.
Exactly.
So let's have her just shoot him away.
Yeah.
They kind of were. It did feel like a little.
They should
awkward.
Have brought in that Skrull guy. He could have repaired it real fast. You know?
Yeah, that's that guy.
So or one of his compatriots scoops him up and gets. She's agonizing over whether or not she should kill him, and then one of his people takes him away.
Wait, but at some point, though, he's the epic enemy. He is the guy that fooled her, lied to her, manipulated her.
6 years.
Oh, terrible. It should have been a lot harsher. I just felt like she literally was like, go ahead, get out of here, and smacked him on the butt.
He's just one of the bad crew, right?
Yeah.
So she's going to go deal with that problem.
Yeah, but why didn't she destroy the other ships then?
Why not?
Kills one of the ships. Why didn't she just destroy the other two? They were in Earth airspace. These are truly the bad guys.
Because that guy has to be in another movie.
Exactly.
Why not just bring him to the authorities? I'm sure S.H.I.E.L.D. would love to interrogate that guy and try to get some information out of him.
Well, S.H.I.E.L.D.'s not ready to interrogate that guy.
Yeah, S.H.I.E.L.D. doesn't know what they're
doing. I have other nits. I feel like I'm mischaracterizing my actual feelings about the movie because I'm happy to shift into some good scenes now. I have a great scene that I loved. Arguably my favorite scene in the movie. I just think it was so adorable.
This was inspired.
So they're all in the house. And they have the disc, literally a DVD.
Oh, yeah, this is
and they
brilliant.
Put it into a 1995 awesome. Computer. And everybody that was alive back then who saw the old versions of
the dialogues
Google,
that pop up and
the drop-down boxes.
Oh, my God.
So the scene was magnificent. the progress bar is going. And anybody that was alive then has sat there, the idiot, watching progress bar go, because you're just like, please load, hurry up, what's happening? So that's what the characters are experiencing. So they click to one person, and they're like, then they click to one of the scroll guys, who we think is a bad guy at that point. And even he's going, like, what is going on with this thing? That, to me, was such a funny scene.
And somebody says, what's happening?
No, Captain Marvel's
like,
what is
this?
What's happening? It's loading.
It's loading. That was great.
That was a great scene.
I'd love to be in that meeting when that scene was born, because somebody was like, we need to punch up this scene. And somebody's like, let's do the old slow loading thing.
You know that there was a whole, like, 1990s.
Yes.
Yeah. In the 90s. Nostalgia. Yeah. Layer to this movie, and that was definitely.
They probably had a bucket list. Okay. All right, we got to do this.
I wasn't really happy how they represented the AI, and it was too. It was like a throwback to like very simple-minded villains in the 80s, right? Because Annette Bening, I love Annette Bening. Mm-hmm. I've seen her in tons of movies. I always enjoy her performance. I didn't really enjoy her performance in this movie. Her characterization of the AI was the age-old, like the AI is putting on this ironic smile to make it seem creepy. And it was such an abused cliche of like, no, why couldn't the AI have just been totally stone cold? Like, why would it?
Well, okay. So first of all, I have to say I love the fact that the Kree civilization is run by an AI.
Me too.
Right?
We need more AIs running society.
That would happen a lot.
I want an AI to run our society.
Stop. Is that it, Bob? Yeah, is that your final word?
So that was, I like that whole thing. And they did do some interesting things with, you know, interfacing with the AI.
Sure.
But again, this was her... The concept of somebody she respected, that the AI was drawing upon something from her to create this, you know, persona to interact with. That wasn't the AI. That was just a skin for her. And so that you can kind of excuse that. But
I don't know if I agree with that.
There's definitely a layer there. But the other thing is, we don't really know what the AI's motivation is. You know, we really get just a very limited glimpse at what they're doing. So I don't think we could say at this point that the AI was a cardboard villain. Yes, we sort of, that what we saw looked that way, but, you know, it's we really don't know what their motivation is.
I get it, but do you think
But they could have done a better job at making her more mysterious.
That's what I'm asking for. I just didn't want it to be so, like, because to me, I looked at it and was like, that's kind of silly. I wanted to feel intimidated by that AI.
Yeah.
And to me, I just thought it was what?
They could have easily had just another scene with another one interacting with the AI and have it be this, like, really, scary dude, scary person. They could have shown the different faces of the AI.
Give you more of a sense that, wow, this is really a million times more intelligent than any human being, and we can't really know what it's thinking and be more intimidating.
Right, give it some depth.
Right, and they even said at the very beginning, nobody sees what the AI looks like, because you were, like, you know, looking at the face of Cthulhu, you would go nuts type of thing.
So How did that chip stop her from accessing her powers? She had that little chip on her neck.
I think it's psychological. I think that when you think that your powers are given to you by some outside source, then you're more easily manipulated into not reaching your full power.
Yeah, but they turned her powers off with it.
They did, but whatever, they did. That's, again, it's alien super technology, so they made it work.
They probably examined the hell out of her to find out how she got that awesome power. They found out some conduit, some way they could interfere with the flow of the energy.
That was her infinity chakra they were blocking.
You say so. To me, I thought that was kind of strange.
All right, so I think we do have to talk about a little bit of the elephant in the room. So this is the first Marvel movie that was where a female superhero led.
It was the lead.
It was her origin story. First female Marvel director. Movie with a female director. And that's created a lot of controversy, unnecessarily. The first thing, like my wife and I were, when we were going to see the movie, she's like, wow, this is 80% critic review and 34 or 36% popular review on Rotten Tomatoes. Why, it's like almost a 50-point disconnect. You never see it in that direction.
Right.
What's going on here? Yeah. I'm like, I think I know what's going on here. I think this is a lot of downvotes from people who are just uncomfortable with the fact that this is a female superhero Marvel movie.
Even before the movie was out.
Even before the movie was out, giving
bad reviews, which is ridiculous.
What's funny is, like, I didn't even realize this, that there was anything, like, out of the movie drama going on. Like, who cares? Like, I totally don't understand, like... First off, Captain Marvel is a very old superhero. Mm-hmm. totally canon. Like, what's the beef? It's a great, it's a, mm-hmm. one of the great heroes to bring to life. Why wouldn't we do it?
I think, you know, one of the things I like about science fiction and speculative fiction is the way it interacts with culture. It's a reflection of our culture. It's almost like putting a mirror up to our society and what we care about. Like, what do we want out of this genre? Why do we go and see superhero movies? And I think that, you know, the idea that Marvel and DC, you know, with Wonder Woman, are trying to, you know, have more diversity in their superhero canon is a great thing. It reflects society. And the people who are pushing back against this movie are the same people who are pushing it back against that cultural trend and cultural phenomenon. We're just seeing it played out. You know, we talk about the fact, like, Black Panther was the same thing. We know people. We have friends, you know, of ours who are African American who saw Black Panther and like, I finally get it. I know now why you guys are fanboying superheroes, because I can now relate in a way that I couldn't relate before. Right. I think that's fantastic.
And I think it's so important. Also, I mean, obviously that's wonderful, but I think it's so important for people who are in, you know, the quote unquote typical, right? The white male, to see role models who are not white men.
Yeah.
It's important for little boys too, you know?
Right. And it's like, what I liked how they handled it in the movie, because it, you know, I thought they did it was just the perfect, I think, sweet spot of, it was part of her origin that she had to overcome this. Like, everyone telling her, like, there was the one montage of everyone telling her, like, she's on the ground, Jean, you can't do it, you're too weak. And she gets up and she's a badass.
That.
That's a typical superhero kind of.
Exactly, right?
It was totally overcoming odds.
The next time I see the Black Panther on screen, I'm going to be like, you know, and the same thing with Captain Marvel, and the same thing with Wonder
Woman.
It gave
that character a lot more gravitas.
Absolutely.
And same thing with Captain Marvel. I do think that this movie gave the Captain Marvel character a lot more gravitas.
Oh my God, it does
tie into the Infinity War, because that when the shit hit the fan, that's who Nick Fury called.
Yep.
Right?
Absolutely.
And now we see, of course, that she answers.
She is powerful.
She's
look what she did to
that
Superman ship.
Superman level. She's powerful.
Some people are saying she's too powerful, which to me is an oxymoron. But I can't wait to see what she does.
How else would they get out, you know, out of the situation with Thanos? Yeah.
If you're going up against Thanos, you have to be that powerful.
I can't wait to see what they do to pull
that rabbit. Yeah, me too. I'm excited to see her interact with her. I want to see what happens when they
say
hi to each other, and they, you know, it's like a new person in town with that power, you know. Like, that's serious. Like, they have to take massive note of her and what her capabilities are. This is not a minor. You know, this isn't someone that could teleport from here to there. This is like someone that could do hundreds of things.
But one of the really cool things about this movie, some of the supporting characters were really good, and I loved her relationship with her friend and her friend's daughter. They were awesome. Like, the friend was, I totally bought her as another really cool, powerful woman who just, I love that they, you know, they didn't get their power from being superheroes. They were already awesome.
Yeah. Right. And they made that point. You were the strongest person I knew before you had superpowers.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. And I mean, these women were fighter pilots in the 90s.
Yes.
I mean, that's something. That's something even today that's also something. But back then, they, you know, they must be superheroes, even without a cape. Right.
Final word is, I thought it was a great movie, a good addition to the Marvel franchise. Looking forward to seeing her interacting with everyone else in the Infinity War sequel.
And definitely wait till the end of the credits.
Yeah,
the very end, you get
the double
Easter
egg. Yeah.
We'll say no more.
Keep raising the bar. Our criticisms are with love, right? Because this is a great movie, I enjoyed it. Yes, these are things that could have made it even better, but overall, I think Marvel is doing a great job.
Because we want a perfect experience. Like, as an example, my wife and I just watched the movie Aliens last night, right? I hadn't watched it in probably, it could have been a decade.
That was a perfect movie.
It is perfect.
It is a perfect movie.
And it was
Jurassic Park.
Yeah, the first Jurassic Park.
I totally agree.
Not any of the sequels, but the first one was.
Yeah. But, you know, Aliens is a female lead.
John Carpenter's a thing.
She is
perfect.
I want to talk about this movie though. Like, she is.
Maybe you should do an AQ6 about this movie.
No, I would definitely.
We could do that. We'll do an AQ6 on perfect science fiction movies.
But I love the fact that in 1 week I watched two movies with a female lead. That these movies were exquisite science fiction, and they're intimidating characters. You know, like, Sigourney Weaver plays this character so intensely. She is loyal. She loves her friends. She gets it done. Like, when you said get it done, she's truly a hero. Because when the shit hit the fan, in every aspect of the movie, she needed to do something in order to
do it.
And she does it.
And she did better than the trained
Yeah.
You know, military guys.
Much like Laura Dern.
Mm-hmm. That's true. No, I agree. And I love that. I love watching movies about characters that just like keep, they just don't give up. They just keep going. And there's some great works of science fiction novels that maybe we could talk about someday where, again, like the ones that really stand out in my memory were like, they just keep on going and they don't give up. They go and you just it's believable when it's believable that they can accomplish what they can accomplish, not because of their powers, but because of their attitude
and their drive and
their drive.
Frodo.
And because they care, because they care, you know. Yeah. So I thought that she.
It's
totally
a heavy dose of competency porn, though. And we mentioned this a lot with Star Trek. Star Trek's backbone is competency porn. And that superhero is the same thing.
Yes. That's why I love Buffy. Buffy's absolutely like that. The one when she kills the Uber vamp in Thunderdome. And
and again, like Star Trek, like why does Captain Kirk and Spock do the things that they do? Because it's the right thing to do.
Yeah.
That's why. They do it because someone's got to do it and it's the right thing to do. Yeah. And that's what we love about superhero movies. That to me is sort of the bedrock of the genre.
We all need these role models. I mean, it doesn't matter how old I get. I mean, Spider-Man is a very young superhero, like in the new Spider-Man in particular.
Very young.
I look up, I just can't help it. I'm a little kid again. I look up to them. I want to be a better person.
Yes.
I'm fairly certain a large portion of my like moral compass was developed from Buffy and Angel.
Yeah, of course.
No, I do. I think again, society influences these movies, and then these movies influence society. Yeah. Absolutely. This is our mythology. These are our stories.
Yeah.
And the mythology that we tell is a story about what matters to us. It is about our morals, you know.
Yeah.
And that's why I think we could do worse than to have superheroes who care be our role models, right? And I think Captain Marvel completely deserves to be in that role. And there you have it.
So if you enjoy this show, if you want to see more of these, you can go to Alpha Quadrant 6. That's Alpha Quadrant and the number 6.com. That's our website. We also have a Facebook page. We are on YouTube and we are on Patreon. So you can find all of our links there. Thank you for watching. We have a lot more coming this year. We have some great plans this year. And I dare say we might have something spectacular coming early next year. Something huge that we're already working on.
See you next time.